speaker is Professor Narinder Pani, who will address us on understanding endemic corruption. Dr. Pani is a professor here in ENS. He's an economist by training who has had a deep interest in multidisciplinary research and teaching. He has, over the last 35 years, written exclusively and extensively on a variety of subjects. He's the author of Inclusive Economics, The Andean Method and Contemporary Policy, Redefining Conservatism, an essay on the bias of India's economic reform, and Reforms to Preempt Change, Land Legislation in Karnataka. He is the co-author of Women at the Threshold of Globalization and the co-editor of Bengaluru, Bangalore, Bengaluru, Imaginations and Their Times. He has published a number of academic articles in India and abroad. He is also the author of an explainer of the WTO, a monograph on people's theatre, and has several hundred articles on the editorial pages of newspapers to his credit.
Task of talking about a topic that usually generates more heat than light. We react very emotionally to corruption, and one of the more emotional reactions is usually to international rankings of corruption. And when you have the same Transparency International coming up with the corruption ranking, typically countries have opposed it, saying that the criteria are not valid, that when you have the same criteria put across many different countries, what we are doing is actually choosing the wrong criteria. For instance, the US sees nothing wrong in lobbying, but the lobbying factor in the Bofors deal almost brought down the bomb, and certainly in some ways ended Mr. Rajiv Gandhi's career. So you have a situation where people argue that it's because of the conditions. Recently, researchers have been arguing that we can get beyond that by looking at behavior of people from different cultures in international organizations. So it started with a simple test of looking at parking tickets in the UN in New York. And the pattern was very, very clear. The countries that were higher in the corruption index were also much higher in terms of simple things like the diplomats from those countries or the representatives of those countries were typically much higher in terms of the number of parking tickets they earned. This example has gone on to other areas. Oxford has had brought students together and done an experiment with them, and the same result. So it's no longer possible to dismiss this as simply a matter of the criteria set by the West. There are clearly indicators that some countries, or some cultures actually, are more prone to corruption than others. So what I'm going to try to do today is try and argue, find out why, or at least try to argue why Indian society is a little more prone, much more prone to corruption than some of the societies in Europe, particularly in the Scandinavian countries. So what I will do is essentially three sets of things. First, I think it's important to conceptualize what we mean by corruption. It is a term that's used very lightly. The second is the gap. We'll try and argue that basically the cause of corruption is because there's a gap between legality and morality, and I'll try to trace that gap with the coming of colonialism. And then I will try and argue that the post-independence response or attitudes to the constitution and legality have only served to widen this gap. And therefore you have a situation where it is morally all right to break the law. It's morally valid to break the law. So to begin with conceptualizing corruption, I'll go through this a little quickly. Essentially, there is to be expected a large number of definitions of corruption, and there are really three. Heidemann must probably summed it up the best when he argues that there are three types of definitions. One is public office centric, the other is market centric, and the third is public interest centric. And it would be better to work with a more generalized definition, which is what is there with Transparency International, which argues that defines corruption as abuse of entrusted power for private gain. Now, the important words here are entrusted power, which is a move away from early definitions which looked at public office for private gain. This is largely because of the rise of crony capitalism in some countries. But it's also particularly important in India because we have issues of family and other such elements coming in. And they can, though they don't not officially a part of any government, they come out and they are, in fact, a major source of corruption. When we work with the idea of corruption, we need to move from that very general definition to a more operational one. And one that is now getting wide recognition is that typically a case of corruption is when a public official acting for personal gain violates the norms of public office and harms the interests of the public to benefit a third party who rewards him or her for access to goods or services which the other party would not otherwise obtain. Now, this is a general definition, but the impression sometimes created that all this has to be done before you're termed corrupt, which would not be true. You need to make two changes here. One is the public official has to be extended to include all those with entrusted power. And the second is that if any part of this definition is broken, there is a case for corruption. When you're acting for personal gain, violates norm of personal or public office, that itself is corruption. Harms the interests of the public when doing so is also corruption. To benefit a third party is another form of corruption, and then gaining rewards is also corruption. So there are four different components, and if any one of them is broken, I think we need to take it as a case of corruption. When we do that, it will be useful that this distinction is broken into two kinds of looking at it analytically as to why this occurs. It's important to break it, I think, into two different types of corruption. One is what I would call non-cooperative corruption. That is the first part of what we took. That is, a public official acting for personal gain violates the norm of public office and harms the interests of the public. This is essentially that those entrusted with power generate illegal private gain from carrying out tasks that are legal in themselves. That is, if I have something like, I go for a driving license, it's a perfectly legal requirement, but I still am asked to pay a bribe. Right? So it is an illegal act for a perfectly legal task, right? The thing about this form of corruption is it is sensitive to policing. If I increase make the laws more stringent, if I increase the number of policemen who are actually monitoring this form of corruption can be brought down. There should not be too much of a problem, except in another context which I'll come to. Cooperative corruption, on the other hand, deals with the second part of that. That is, a public official acting for personal gain violates the norms of public office to benefit a third party. And this is where the difficulty in dealing with corruption comes in. Because essentially here, what we're saying is those entrusted with power generate illegal private gain by carrying out illegal acts for a client. That you're basically following an illegal process, and the act itself that you're carrying out for a client is illegal. So essentially what we're talking about there is that that essentially this of course is what, like, if I go for a to have to for building regulations, I go to change my building regulations, make them illegal, I need to pay somebody for it, and that's a wide element there. The critical thing here is the number of clients that come in, and here you can get situations where once you have, say, 20% of your population doing it, 30% of the population, you move, it's no longer the exception, it becomes the rule. Yesterday you had the minister talking about regulations in Bangalore. Up to 20 years ago, it wasn't very much, and for various reasons which I don't want to go into now. Essentially, once people started changing it, a larger number of people started breaking the regulations. Now the official, you have the minister standing on a public platform and saying 95% of the buildings in Bangalore do not follow it. And that's a sudden spurt that happens, because once you say as a society, nobody's following this, the rest say, why should I follow it? And earlier, even 5 years ago, the estimate was 80%, but now the official estimate is 95%. So that process occurs, so that's what makes it really difficult, because now you're getting a stake in corruption for the vast majority of society. A large part of society now would benefit from corruption. That makes it resistant to policing. any policing can be done when you're dealing with criminals who are assumed to be a small part of society. When the vast majority of society become lawbreakers, there's very little that any police force can do. Right? You can try your best. Over time, what is more likely to happen is the police force itself gets corrupted. Because essentially, that's the society, and that's the argument, and the fact that the minister is making, that essentially society is like that, we cannot be different. Right? And that's a process that occurs. It is also resistant to the market. Indeed, the market in such cases might work in the opposite direction. The height of increasing the real estate prices means that for every foot you leave for a space that you are supposed to leave from the board, you're actually in effect losing lakhs of rupees as the real estate prices shoot up. So when that happens, people are tempted. The market, which is supposed to help, now becomes difficult. In fact, the whole idea that you could reduce corruption by just reducing the role of the government, which is the argument that Dr. Manmohan Singh made back in the 1990s, right, proved to be fundamentally wrong for various reasons. One is it's not just government, but also the entrusted officials. Right? So you could have family, you could have other people coming in there. Secondly, it is fundamentally wrong because when I reduce the number of areas that are covered, it doesn't mean even the number of opportunities, all that happens is the price of each opportunity goes up. Because that you really want a control, say, over the telecom market, and you don't want others to get it. They're just a question of licensing. The cost of those licenses shoot up to astronomical numbers. So essentially, the extent of corruption, you might have fewer cases of corruption, but the corruption cases become massive in the magnitude. So essentially, the market then, idea that you can use the market to fight corruption is quite misleading. So the only way you can fight this corruption then is through moral pressure. That people must believe it is wrong. If people believe it is right, there's no way you can fight it. So corruption then becomes a case where of morality being leading to a different solution or a different action than legality. If you create a society when it is morally okay to be illegal, people will be illegal. There is absolutely no element there. And in some sense, that is at the heart of the Indian problem, because until independence, you had two dimensions to the debate. One was the rationality dimension, the other was the morality dimension, and Gandhi pushed the morality dimension as hard as anyone could have, and that remained a part of the debate. And by the 1940s, Gandhi was sort of kicked upstairs to a sainthood, and therefore no longer a part of policy making or decisions in any way. But nevertheless, he had an influence. But in the post-independence era, anyone talking of morality was seen as someone who's some kind of a quirk, maybe an idealist, maybe he goes to sit in a forest. Morality was not considered a valid argument to make in rational circles. Right? So it's a bit surprising that to find 65 years after arguing that morality is not a valid argument to make, people are now worried about it, are worried about the consequences of it. Right? Because if we argue as we did then, and this argument is actually very deeply entrenched into what we do. Right? I think the whole Anna Hazare movement, an anti-corruption movement, the main demand of the anti-corruption movement was a change in the law. Not once at any point did somebody say, what are we doing about our morality? Right? So that becomes a difference. So what you're saying now is that I have a problem with my morality, but I try to bring the legality in. And essentially what has happened is that you have a situation where morality is at the heart of the problem. So I'd like to spend a minute on trying to understand what we mean by that. And to do so, it's useful to make a distinction that philosophers usually do. And that's a distinction they say the term morality can be used either descriptively or normatively. That's essentially the element. Descriptive is to codes of conduct that are put forward by society without judging whether they're right or wrong. We just say those are the conducts, behavior. If it is accepted in Bengaluru to actually break the norms, that is the morality of Bengaluru. Right? We did a survey and asked people, and this can vary from city to city. We did a survey of different cities in Bengaluru and asked them how many of you pay property tax. House owners who were supposed to pay property tax, we asked them how many of you pay property tax. That number in Bengaluru
versus almost a quarter of the houses. They said they do not pay property. So it's not as if they don't pay and they hide it. They're openly saying that they're part of the morality of the city, that there's no good home in not paying property tax. It's a part of, that links up to the irregularity of all other regulations that you see there. So really what we're looking at is the sense of morality, and cooperative corruption then occurs when there's a gap between descriptive morality and legality. We don't get into normative morality here because that's what we should be doing and those are debates. But if I have a descriptive morality in a city and legality is somewhere else, then we get into cooperative corruption. And if we create a society where it is endemic, where essentially the gap between legality and morality is very high, we end up with endemic corruption. So the question then is, how did it happen in India? And I would argue that essentially let's take what happened to, let's get a sense first of what we mean by British legality in the form that it was brought into India. This essentially begins primarily, there is the early Whig philosophy of the late 18th century. But by the time the British actually take control of much of India, it's the rise of utilitarianism there. You have the idea of Bentham arguing about utilitarianism, and along with it, he comes with this idea of legal positivism, which essentially means that the law, the justification of the law is built within itself. There is no justification that has to be given outside from morality, that the morality is built into the law. And in that legal positivist framework, the law was then seen as the commands of the sovereign. And if the sovereign has given some commands, there's no question of morally checking whether those commands are valid or not. Mm-hmm. And it was that law that was brought into India. I mean, the whole question of the role of utilitarianism in Indian thought through the British is a long one. But just at this point out that James Mill, both James Mill and his son, the two major utilitarian thinkers post-Bentham, were employed by the East India Company. So India became the first sort of laboratory where they could try out their ideas, and in many of the cases they used them. It was resisted for some time in the element, but essentially it came up with the idea at the same time of the rise of rationality, and the rise of the Enlightenment, and therefore it became essential to be based on proof. The idea was deeply entrenched that you had to have complete proof. It was better to let a guilty person go than to hang an innocent one. So the idea was very scientific. You had scientific proof and only then you acted on it. Okay? So you're innocent until proven guilty. And you had essentially the rights of individuals more than family. It was essentially an individual-centric philosophy, and you functioned with that. So it was more than family, and it was also more than groups. Now, this British legality was superimposed on an Indian morality. In Mysore, it happened in 1834. In other parts of the country, it happened at different times. And the first thing in Indian morality, which was certainly there at the time, and in many ways continues till today, is the loyalty to the family. It is a critical part of what you do. It is, in many ways, what you accept. And this is something, this loyalty to the family and the role of the family is something that you can work out in many ways. I mean, just one example, in the entire subcontinent, you have women prime ministers, though you have very poor gender relations. And the reason simply is that the family, the loyalty to the family is supreme. So if there's no male member of the family, the woman gets that role. So you have a family-dominated system. You also have one dominated by identity groups. I won't go into this in detail, but somebody who studied this quite effectively is M.K. Gandhi, and Gandhi links his concept of Swadeshi to this. But I think we all know around us that there are castes, etc., which played a primary role in the legal system in pre-British India, and they were a part of it, so we didn't even spend much time with it. The third element is on the question of subjectivity in argument. The Indian logic itself never believed that you can make an argument without doubt. To give a very an example that the philosophers in the audience would probably correct me, is that essentially it's a question, the argument example is that of the serpent and the rope. If I see a rope and I think it's a serpent, right, or I doubt that it's a serpent, there is a question of my doubt being a part of my knowledge in Indian philosophy. Whereas in Western philosophy, the knowledge starts only when I realize it's a rose. So I cannot have complete objective proof because I'm also taking doubt into account. I take subjectivity into account. So when I'm making an argument, I'm also taking subjectivity into the process. Now this is a critical argument for the way you look at law itself, which we'll come to in a minute. So the whole focus then is on persuasion rather than proof. I have to persuade people that they are right or that they are wrong rather than looking at complete proof. And in this process where I can look at subjectivity, my response to oppression is not necessarily open rebellion. Right? Deception has been seen as an effective response against oppression. And this is a pre-British phenomenon. I mean, you have Bertenstein's classical work arguing that Indian villages didn't bother too much about the Mughal Empire, though they belonged to it in some ways. Mr. Shetter will correct me if I'm wrong, but they belonged to it in some ways. But essentially, all that happened was that once a year somebody came to collect that money, they paid them the money or whatever they had to, their dues once a year, and after that, they had nothing to do. They were completely on their own, they were completely there. And that one year, if they could deceive them in some way about the amounts to be paid, it was perfectly valid, perfectly acceptable. Right? Deceiving the revenue collector about the amount of revenue that was there. Right? But then along with that process comes a price to be paid for deceiving those officers. Right? And this leads to a number of forms of corruption. That is, you try and, I mean, this is an example that is there from Old Mysore. There was an officer who had managed one of his last interviews back, I think, in the 1970s. And he was a member of the Indian Civil Service. And he used to say that when he started off in the Mysore Civil Service in villages, that any official application on which a 1 rupee coin was not placed, right, it was believed to have flown away. So essentially, you had the idea of a paperweight as an essential form to keep the elements going. So you have the whole process linked up to a particular morality. And in this kind of a situation, your legal system was related to that. Right? There was essentially the panchayat was one about coming up with an agreement rather than finding the guilty. So there's a prior commitment from both sides to accept the decision of the panchayat. The case was decided by Babu, so there was no written evidence to later bring into account. Right? The written agreement was given to both parties, but not the evidence itself. No appeal was allowed, and prior to the order, appeal could be made saying that the evaluation of the judgment would not be fair. But once the order was passed, there was no appeal allowed. So the nature of that authority was itself quite different. First of all, the judges had to be people who knew the parties. They couldn't be objective, they couldn't be far away, because you were seeing the case and you were making a judgment, including a subjective judgment. You needed to know the parties. So as Mark Cuban noted in his famous report of 1838, the best and most efficient judge in such a community is the one who, from a situation, has the most intimate knowledge of those between whom he is called upon to decide. Right? The second element is how do you deal with partiality? And here again, Cuban is surprised but notes. The natives would in general prefer with the risk of occasional partiality and informality, prompt justice administered on the spot by officers well acquainted with the parties to a reference to a distant tribunal where the judge is incapacitated by want of the same information from forming the correct decision. I will come back late to this point later to argue that this is still there in India, as will be seen in our response to television media trials. But the idea of the response of the nature of the process is there. Another security against partiality exists in the publicity of judicial proceedings, so the influence of public opinion on the spot must be exerted on the conduct. There is an idea of a public court, and even today you find the idea of mobs working out, or even on traffic disputes, playing the particular roles within that. So what happens here is, staying with Cuban, that it follows as a consequence of this principle that the panchayats are anxious for the examination of collateral facts, or matters of general notoriety, and of all that enters into circumstantial evidence, that their decisions are infinitely more influenced by that description of proof than is consistent with the received rule of evidence which we are accustomed or would be tolerated in the practice of an English court. So you're seeing now that the nature of the difference is moving into the very nature of legal practice. That the nature of evidence itself is affected by this. Right? And because there's an element of subjectivity in the entire exercise, there is a temporariness to the distance. Right? Governments are sometimes confined in irons for corruption or the neglect of duty or summoned to the usur and exposed before the palaces with their faces covered with mud and the princes in the earth. Yet such men were not by any means looked upon as disgraced, but were frequently appointed to the office. Some of the taluk servants now in employers had to formally serve as such. Once I have subjectivity as a part of my judgment, I cannot make it as permanent and irreversible as I would if I were sure it was based on objective proof. So now you bring in the British courts, and the initial British officers, particularly Marlborough, Metcalfe, recognized this difference, and they tried to come up with systems that were merged, brought in some of these elements of discretion into the judicial system. So you had the rise of paternalism, but once you came up with the rise of utilitarianism, that you and legal positivism, you couldn't do anything. Right? So rather than going in for a change, you needed something with a clear set of rules. And this, the turning point comes in 1833, when Metcalfe argues that our principle is simply this: uniformity where you can have it, diversity where you must have it, but in all cases certainty. In other words, what they were saying was, wherever possible, we'll have a British court. If people don't want to come to it, let them not come to it. Right? So you want personal laws separate, I keep personal laws separate. You want something else separate, I'll keep it separate. In any case, you have to come to these courts, we will not come to you. Right? So essentially, the British response to the gap between morality and legality was to restrict the legality itself to a few areas and let the other system continue as it did on the ground. Right? So this basically changed the two forms of evidence, one in the courts and the other in the panchayats. In the courts, it was, the evidence was supposed to be true. If it wasn't, you went to after the witness with great force on grounds of perjury. But if someone's got to convince me about the larger argument, one cannot argue that, you're allowed to exaggerate, you're allowed to do all kinds of things as a part of your rhetoric. So their perjury becomes a less serious offense. Right? So then the job of perjury itself, it is the duty of the judge to find out whether the person is telling the truth or not. So the attitudes to evidence fundamentally change. It appears to be in the spirit of, this is Mark Wilkes in 1805, just 6 years after Mysore fell to the British. He says, it appears to be in the spirit of English jurisprudence to receive as true the testimony of a competent witness until his credibility is impeached. It is a fixed rule of evidence in Mysore to suspect as false the testimony of every witness until its truth is otherwise supported. And this difference is noticed right then, and it's Cavan again refers to it, and several other people refer to it, but this makes a big difference to the two systems, not in terms of areas where they work, but how you respond to it. Right? So what happens in this system is you develop a system based on rhetoric. And when the courts come in, the rhetoric of the panchayat system and is taken into the courts along with the scope for perjury. And Cavan again notices that the inconsistency of evidence cannot be considered as a proof of falsehood, for there is a tendency among all natives, even when they are in the right, to go beyond the fact in the hope of bettering a good cause. And a skillful opponent might bring discredit on a just cause by taking advantage of such. So now we have a situation where the witness can be right, can be wrong, anything can be done within that, and therefore it creates a huge, there's a limit to the moral pressure against perjury, and you end up with the scope for false cases. Because it depends now on the power I have, how well I can coach my witnesses, and if I want to damage someone else, I can put a false case on that person. And by, this is being said by Benjamin Lewis Rice in 1897, but he's talking of an earlier period itself. And he says, the courts of justice became crowded with impostors who, by inciting the people to litigate, and by the institution of false, vexatious and exaggerated suits carried on the most systematic extortion and so swelled the files of the court that no increase of either judicial establishments or activity on the part of the judges could keep pace with the demand for clearer funds. So the idea of overcrowded courts is not a post-independence idea. It comes directly